Okay, I'm going to show you again something about our diet. And I would like to know what the audience is. And so, who of you ever ate insects? That's quite a lot. But still, you're not representing the overall population of the Earth. Because there's 80% out there that really eats insects. But this is quite good. Why not eat insects? Well, first, what are insects? Insects are animals that walk around on six legs. And here you see just a selection. There are 6 million species of insects on this planet. 6 million species. There's a few hundreds of mammals, 6 million species of insects. In fact, if we count all the individual organisms, we would come at much larger numbers. In fact, of all animals on Earth, of all animal species, 80% walks on six legs. But if we would count all the individuals and we take an average weight of them, it would amount to something like 200 to 2,000 kilograms for each of you and me on Earth. That means that in terms of biomass, insects are more abundant than we are. And we're not on a planet of man, but we're on a planet of insects. Insects are not only there in nature, but they also are involved in our economy, usually without us knowing. There was an estimation, a conservative estimation, a couple of years ago, that the US economy benefited by $57 billion per year. It's a number, very large, a contribution to the economy of the United States for free. And so I looked up what the economy was paying for the war in Iraq in the same year. That was $80 billion. Well, we know that that was not a cheap war. So insects, just for free, contribute to the economy of the United States with about the same order of magnitude, just for free, without everyone knowing. And not only in the States, but in any country, in any economy. What do? They remove dung, they pollinate our crops. A third of all the fruits that we eat are all a result of insects taking care of the reproduction of plants. They control pests, and they're food for animals. They're at the start of food chains. Small animals eat insects, even larger animals eat insects, but the small animals that eat insects are being eaten by larger animals, still larger animals, and at the end of the food chain, we are eating them as well. There's quite a lot of people that are eating insects, and here you see me in a small provincial town in China, Lijiang, about 2 million inhabitants. If you go out for dinner, like in a fish restaurant where you can select which fish you want to eat, you can select which insects you would like to eat. And they prepare it in a wonderful way. And here you see me enjoying a meal with caterpillars, locusts, bee, guppy delicacies. And you can eat something new every day. There's more than 1,000 species of insects that are being eaten all around the globe. That's quite a bit more than just a few mammals that we're eating, like a cow or a pig or a sheep. More than 1,000 species, an enormous variety. And now you may think, okay, in this provincial town in China, they're doing that, but not we. Well, we've seen already that quite some of you already ate insects, maybe occasionally. But I can tell you that every one of you is eating insects, without any exception. You're eating at least 500 grams per year. What are you eating? Tomato soup, peanut butter, chocolate, noodles? Any processed food that you're eating contains insects, because insects are here all around us. And when they're out there in nature, they're also in our crops. As some fruits get some insect damage, those are the fruits, if they're tomato, that go to the tomato soup. If they don't have any damage, they go to the grocery. And that's your view of a tomato. But there's tomatoes that end up in the soup. And as long as they meet the requirements of the food agency, there can be all kinds of things in there, no problem. In fact, why would we put these balls in the soup? There's meat in there anyway. In fact, all our processed foods contain more proteins than we would be aware of. So anything is a good protein source already. Now you may say, okay, so we're eating 500 grams just by accident. We're even doing this on purpose in a lot of food items that we have. I have only two items here on the slide. Pink cookies or surimi sticks, or if you like, Campari. A lot of our food products that are of a red color are dyed with a natural dye. The surimi sticks is crab meat, or is being sold as crab meat. It's white fish that's being dyed with cochineal. A cochineal is a product of an insect that lives off these cacti. It's being produced in large amounts, 150 to 180 metric tons per year, in the Canary Islands, in Peru, and it's big business. 1 gram of cochineal costs about 30 euros. 1 gram of gold is 30 euros. So it's a very precious thing that we're using to dye our foods. Now, the situation in the world is going to change for you and me, for everyone on this earth. The human population is growing very rapidly, and it's growing exponentially. Where at the moment we have something between 6 and 7 billion people, it will grow to about 9 billion in 2050. That means that we have a lot more mouths to feed. And this is something that worries more and more people. There was an FAO conference last October that was completely devoted to this. How are we going to feed this world? And if you look at the figures up there, it says that we have a third more mouths to feed, but we need agricultural production increase of 70%. And that's especially because this world population is increasing, and it's increasing not only in numbers, but we're also getting wealthier. And anyone that gets wealthier starts to eat more, and also starts to eat more meat. And meat, in fact, is something that costs a lot of our agricultural production. Our diet consists for some part of animal proteins. And at the moment, most of us here get it from livestock, from fish, from game. And we're eating quite a lot of it. In the developed world, it's on average 80 kilograms per person per year, which goes up to 120 in the United States, and a bit lower in some other countries, but on average 80 kilograms per person per year. In the developing world, it's much lower, it's 25 kilograms per person per year, but it's increasing enormously. In China, in the last 20 years, it increased from 20 to 50. And it's still increasing. So if a third of the world population is going to increase its meat consumption from 25 to 80 on average, and a third of the world population is living in China and in India, we're having an enormous demand on meat. And of course, we are not there to say, well, that's only for us, it's not for them. They have the same share that we have. Now, to start with, I should say that we are eating way too much meat in the Western world. We could do it with much, much less. And I know I've been a vegetarian for a long time, and you can easily do without anything. You'll get proteins in any kind of food anyway. But then, there's a lot of problems that come with meat production, and we're being faced with that more and more often. The first problem that we're facing is human health. Pigs are quite like us. They're even models in medicine, and we can even transplant organs from a pig to a human. That means that pigs also share diseases with us. And in a pig disease, a pig virus and a human virus can both proliferate, and because of their kind of reproduction, they can combine and produce a new virus. This has happened in the Netherlands in the 1990s during the classical swine fever outbreak. You get a new disease that can be deadly. When you eat insects, they're so distantly related from us that this doesn't happen. So that's 1 point for insects. And there's the conversion factor. If you take 10 kilograms of feed, you can get 1 kilogram of beef, but you can get 9 kilograms of locust meat. So if you would be an entrepreneur, what would you do? With 10 kilograms of input, you can get either 1 or 9 kilograms of output. So far, we're taking the 1 or up to 5 kilograms of output. We're not taking the bonus yet. We're not taking the 9 kilograms of output yet. So that's 2 points for insects. Then there's the environment. If we take 10 kilograms of food and it results in 1 kilogram of beef, the other 9 kilograms are waste. And a lot of that is manure. If you produce insects, you have less manure per kilogram of meat that you produce. So less waste. Furthermore, per kilogram of manure, you have much, much less ammonia and fewer greenhouse gases when you have insect manure than when you have cow manure. So you have less waste, and the waste that you have is not as environmentally malign as it is with cow dung. So that's 3 points for insects. Now there's a big if, of course, and it is if insects produce meat that is of good quality. Well, there have been all kinds of analyses, and in terms of protein, of fat, of vitamins, it's very good. In fact, it's comparable to anything that we eat as meat at the moment. And even in terms of calories, it's very good. 1 kilogram of grasshoppers has the same amount of calories as 10 hot dogs or 6 Big Macs. So that's 4 points for insects. I can go on, and I could make many more points for insects, but time doesn't allow this. So the question is, why not eat insects? I gave you at least 4 arguments in favor. We'll have to. Even if you don't like it, you'll have to get used to this. Because at the moment, 70% of all our agricultural land is being used to produce livestock. That's not only the land where the livestock is walking and feeding, but it's also other areas where the feed is being produced and being transported. We can increase it a bit at the expense of rainforests. But there's a limitation very soon. And if you remember that we need to increase agricultural production by 70%, we're not going to make it that way. We could much better change from meat, from beef, to insects. And then 80% of the world already eats insects. So we're just a minority in a country like the UK, the USA, the Netherlands, anywhere. On the left-hand side, you see a market in Laos where they have abundantly present all kinds of insects that you can choose for dinner for the night. On the right-hand side, you see a grasshopper. And so people there are eating them, not because they're hungry, but because they think it's a delicacy. It's just very good food. You can vary enormously, it has many benefits. In fact, we have delicacy that's very much like this grasshopper. Shrimps, a delicacy being sold at a high price. Who wouldn't like to eat a shrimp? There are a few people that don't like shrimp, but shrimp or crabs or crayfish, it's very closely related. There are delicacies. In fact, a locust is a shrimp of the land. And it would make very good into our diet. So why are we not eating insects yet? Well, that's just a matter of mindset. We're not used to it. And we see insects as these organisms that are very different from us. That's why we're changing the perception of insects. And I'm working very hard with my colleague Arnold van Huys in telling people what insects are, what magnificent things they are, what magnificent jobs they do in nature. And in fact, that without insects, we would not be here in this room. Because if the insects die out, we will soon die out as well. If we die out, the insects will continue very happily. So we have to get used to the idea of eating insects. And some might think, well, they're not yet available. Well, they are. There's entrepreneurs in the Netherlands that produce them. And one of them is here in the audience, Marjan Peters, who's on the picture. I predict that later this year, you'll get them in the supermarkets. Not visible, but as animal protein in the food. And maybe by 2020, you'll buy them just knowing that this is an insect that you're going to eat. And they're being made in the most wonderful ways. A Dutch chocolate maker. So there's a lot of design to it even. Well, in the Netherlands, we have an innovative minister of agriculture, and she puts the insect on the menu in her restaurant, in her ministry. And when she got all the ministers of agriculture of the EU over to The Hague recently, she went to a high-class restaurant and they ate insects all together. It's not something that is a hobby of me. It's really taken off ground. So why not eat insects? You should try it yourself. A couple of years ago, we had 1,750 people all together on a square in Wageningen town, and they ate insects at the same moment, and this was still big, big news. I think soon it will not be big news anymore when we all eat insects, because it's just a normal way of doing. So you can try it yourself today, and I would say enjoy. And I'm going to show to Bruno some first tries, and he can have the first bites.
Look at them first. Look at them first.
It's all protein.
That's exactly the same you saw in the video, actually, and yeah. It looks delicious. They just make it nuts or something. Thank you.
Creative direction on the magazine. I work as a photographer. I also have been curating. I do anything and everything related to photography that I can. Dossier is a biannual art and culture journal. We know so many creative people and we wanted to sort of give people a forum to do projects that they might not be able to do for other magazines. My BlackBerry works with my lifestyle because I actually work from my phone, going back and forth with different clients constantly. If we're planning an issue of the magazine, I'm looking at proofs on my phone. The new one has a keypad and then also a touchscreen. I really like the keypad. I could not write long emails on a phone that just had a touchscreen. There's no way. I started taking pictures seriously when I was about 17, but I just didn't think it was going to be my job. Up until very recently, all of my personal work was pictures of just like what was around me. If I'm sitting around with friends, I usually have my camera. I take a picture of what I see. Bones! Pony! He's like, I guess this is where you want me. The quality of the camera on the BlackBerry is definitely good enough that I can do almost anything I want online with it. I contribute to a couple different blogs aside from the Dossier blog. A lot of times I'll just send them pictures from wherever I am taken with my BlackBerry. This is rainbow eucalyptus in Maui, and it grows by the side of the road. This is taken from the top of the Pompidou in Paris. It's the line to get in. That's a hedgehog in the souk in Marrakesh. It's the inside of my dog's mouth. I just travel a lot for work, you know? I have my phone with me everywhere I go. It works anywhere in the world. And that's awesome.